Good morning, team. I wanted to take today to finish up, like I promised last week, the second set of questions that Renee sent in. Wanted to go over all of these with everyone in a little video because I felt like these are questions that a lot of people ask or maybe are curious about and we can all learn from. So here's part two for you. And let's see. Again, nice and informal here. Just want to go through this stuff with you and give you a little insight. So her next set of questions, all of these, the whole email was based around a lot of questions with professional racing and just a lot of curiosity about what it was like to race as a professional. And, you know, the first one was a little bit more about travel and sponsors and stuff like that. And this gets into more questions on, you know, we'll start with, she wants to know a little bit about with training and training camps and those kinds of things. And the first question is, what's it like to live in a training camp environment? And so that's definitely, I think there's pros and cons to that. You know, living in a training camp environment for periods of the year is really, really, really beneficial. Number one, you're suddenly put in a group of people where everyone is on the exact same, mission, and you're all like-minded, and you're all, hopefully you're in an environment where everyone is either better than you or at the same level as you, and so now suddenly you're forced to step up. And, you know, everyone there, I've lived in a lot of different training environments, whether it was when I went over to New Zealand, or, you know, with Scott and Klaus and Bjorn and Gordo, and there's a group of us that would train together every single day, and it was a training camp type situation, all the way to, you know, living in Boulder, Colorado, where it's more of a day-to-day life, but it is very much like a training camp environment when you're training full-time and you have your peers that you train with, as well as an actual camp with Brett Sutton, where I would do camps in, you know, Philippines, Thailand, Switzerland, where it was a very isolated period of time with a group of athletes. And, you know, some really special things happen. Some great friendships are developed, that kind of thing. But it's a very focused period of time where you're suddenly removed from the rest of the world. In particular, you know, when we went to the Asian camps, we had no real TV, internet access, telephones, anything like that. And you're just now suddenly surrounded by, at that time it was like 30 people who were all the best in the world, whether it be people getting ready for the Olympics or the best Ironman athletes in the world, and we're all on the same mission to just wake up every day and be the very best that you can. You're just by the nature of it going to rise up in your performance because of your, you know, the people that you're around, your peers every single day. There's no distractions and you really rise up. Now, is that also an environment that is sustainable year round, year after year? Probably not. I think, you know, there's going to be times where you need breaks from that, and it's good to go back to normal real life, as well as, you know, if you're at the bottom of the pecking order with that kind of situation, it's good to go into environments where you're the bottom and having to rise up. But it's also good to remove yourself from that for a little while and go to places where, you know, maybe you go back to your hometown where you're the big fish in the small pond and you get to lead everyone and everyone's trying to keep up with you. So there's a bring yourself up piece of this, but there's also a piece where, you know, that can beat you down a little bit too much, and you need to then have periods of time where it's more relaxed, you go away from that, and you're the leader, and people are trying to keep up with you. So I think it's a balance for sure. You know, focusing on training as your job, and now it's your job, it's just like anything else. You know, fortunately, when you're an athlete, you're doing something you love. It's your choice to do that. And, you know, a lot of people get to do what they love. People take on professions that they really love what they do. But like anything, when it becomes a job, now, you know, when you're tired or you're sore or you maybe don't feel like it that day or you'd rather hit the snooze button or you have a little bit of an injury or you're, you know, a little bit under the weather or something like that, it's no longer a choice to say, I don't feel like doing this today. Or, you know, I'm bored or I would like to do a different session or, you know, all of those things that it's when you're not doing it for a living, you can kind of have a little bit of a leeway. Now when you're doing it for a living, I used to joke with a good friend of mine, we used to talk about how it's Groundhog Day. There's like two sessions all year that are really memorable. And now what was like most of the, you know, it's not that it's not still fun because you love what you do. So of course it's fun. But now it's a little bit more, you know, everything matters. There isn't room for you to mess up on your diet. There isn't room for you to mess up on your recovery. There isn't room for you to decide that you want to go out that weekend and not be, you know, at your best on Sunday morning for your long session, those kinds of things. Your job now is 24/7 to be absolutely geared towards performing your best and looking after your body to perform your best and put everything to every session. So it's a little bit of a different thing in that I'd say the biggest difference is you have to do it whether you feel like it or not. And sometimes you have to do it in circumstances where you feel like you can't, but you have to anyway, so there's just no choice anymore. So, you know, being a certain weight or body shape or having certain sleep or pushing through some things that might be more uncomfortable than what you would, those kinds of things. Now it's not an option. So you know, just like any job, there's when you do something you love, there's good parts and then there's parts where it's just work. Is it competitive in a good, in a camp and training environment? Yeah, of course. I mean, competition is good and that's what's going to raise you up. You put, you know, a pack of type A competitive people together that aren't competing as a team. So it's not like going to a camp with like a rugby team or a football team where your whole purpose of the camp is to come together and work as a team. Everyone there is an individual athlete competing for an individual sport, but you're working in a camp environment. So you develop bonds and friendships with certain people, and you really, those become your great training partners because maybe you help bring each other up and you support each other and you push each other, but you're not competitive to the point where you break each other down. Those become your long-term training partners and often your best friends. Then there is people that in training camps that maybe you're just not going to get along, or maybe it's, you know, by nature, you're a little bit too competitive. And so you got to watch for that kind of stuff. So certainly there is that dynamic, just like, you know, any group that you put together. But now you've got a group of type A people who all are competing for, you know, a similar thing on an individual basis. So there's definitely a tricky environment there. And they have to manage that well and recognize what works for you and what doesn't, and what's going to bring you up and what's going to tear you down. Simple things like how do you deal with laundry, personal business, grocery shopping, that kind of stuff. I mean, that's on you. You know, when we were in a camp in Thailand with Brett, there was no car, there was no, you know, we didn't have anything. We were just there with our stuff and there was no, you know, washing machines, and our kitchen literally was, we're living in, there was, you know, for every four or five athletes, there was like a communal kitchen area, and then you had your own little bunks, and then like the next house was the same thing, and the next house the same thing. And, you know, there was no washing machines or anything like that, and our kitchen consisted of like one little hot plate and a tiny little fridge that we all had to share. Now, we also had a restaurant that we could call in and get food, but, you know, cooking and going to the grocery store and for laundry and stuff like that, I mean, I just, for the most part, hand washed everything in the sink and then hung it up, and then we had to ride our bikes into town where we could actually do a big load of laundry like once a week with a backpack and then ride home. And same thing, like once a week, maybe someone, Brett would have a car that we could drive in and all do like a big grocery shop. And other than that, it was like ride your bike to the nearest convenience store or little, you know, market or something like that. So certainly in those kinds of circumstances. And then, you know, if you're in a camp somewhere that's not as rural or, you know, in a different country or whatever, absolutely. I mean, nobody does that stuff for you. You still have to manage your own life and manage your own equipment and manage your own, you know, all that stuff. That's on you 100%. Some of these I'm going to answer and some of them I'm going to skip through a little bit. You know, personal safety, that kind of stuff. You asked about, you know, did you ever feel unsafe? No, I mean, there is definitely different dynamics of being in different countries. The only time I actually ever physically felt scared was a couple times I got lost. That was a bit scary, but just because I get lost really easy, and that might have been like, oh man, how do I find my way home? There is no like phones and stuff like that. It's just find your way home. And then another time I got kind of scared is one time in Thailand. I was riding by myself and this guy on a motorbike came up beside me and was kind of harassing me a little bit and wouldn't go away no matter what and didn't speak English. And that was a bit overwhelming. But other than that, eventually he did just go away and leave me alone. The other things to deal with were like the wild dogs in those countries that chase you, but we figured out pretty quickly if you sprayed them in the face with your Gatorade, it worked like maize and they would leave you alone. So, you know, there's different dynamics. Most of the time you're in countries and places and training camps that are, you know, really, really no problem. And like I talked about in my video last week, you have to be, if you choose to be a professional endurance athlete, you got to endure. You got to endure and adapt. So, you know, part of going to these camps is you're going to be put in situations where you have to deal with things that are not. None of these camps are designed for things to be perfect for you every day. In fact, sometimes they're pretty complicated and hard. And that's the point. I mean, we're being taught to push each other, rise up, but nothing is served to you on a silver platter. I mean, you've got to step up and prove that you belong there with everybody else and that you're good enough because there's a natural pecking order and that you need to, you know, step up and be there. And then as far as looking after your life and adapting to difficult conditions and different places and those kinds of things, I mean, it is 100% on you to just step up, handle it and step up. And that is going to prepare you and determine really how you're going to be able to be a professional endurance athlete. I mean, it's hard work. This is a profession that you've chosen that you're saying, I am going to race for, you know, somewhere between, let's say the guys 8 hours to females down to 10 hours for a living. So you've got to have some durability to you and ability to just adapt, roll, and carry on. And so these camps are designed to teach you that a little bit. They're not easy, and nothing is handed to you so that every session is perfect. In fact, most of the time, there's obstacles in your way to try and make that session as hard as possible, and you've got to figure that out. So that's, you know, people who think, oh, pros just like get to sleep in and wake up and get all the perfect massages and whole foods and chefs and everything looked after for them, and they just have all these happy, great sessions, and you know, everything is great all the time. That's not the case. I mean, for the most part, most professionals also still work. There's not enough money in the sport for most of them to not still have some kind of part-time job that they're doing when they're not training, as well as you got to fight tooth and nail to get yourself to a point where you're, you know, up at that level and you're all fighting for the same thing. So this is not something that is going to be easy, and it's going to take a long time, and you're going to have to put up with and endure a lot. So now in saying that, that's also, you get a lot of amazing stories, great friendships, really discover a lot about yourself. You know, all of these things are just going to become a part of your life that you could never imagine in any other circumstances. You know, it's such a different way to go about your life that it's, you know, you're given a lot of gifts along the way too. You know, deeper friendships than what you would normally get in a normal life. Like I say, see parts of the world that you would never maybe see in a different way. Challenges for yourself that you never in a million years would put yourself in that position yourself. So it's pretty special as well. And then on top of that, you get to go to a race and do what you love and hopefully do well enough that you actually make a living doing it. So, you know, you ask a little bit about what's it like to handle the pressure of people watching you and, you know, amateurs and media and all that stuff, having all these expectations. I think, you know, that's a part of being a professional athlete that you have to learn to manage. You definitely, some people handle it better than others. Some people rise up to that kind of pressure. Some people buckle underneath that kind of pressure. I think if you have prepared well and you focus on yourself and you just continue to love what you do and do your best every single day, all of that is going to fall into place. I mean, you can only do what you can do. So no amount of, you know, pressure or, you know, anything like that is going to make your job or your result any different. You know, I think you can feed off of it to rise up and you know, perform, bring more out of yourself than maybe what you thought. But really, you do what you love, you work hard at it, you prepare the best you can, you show up at races ready to go, fired up to race and do your best, and love the fact that there are people willing to support you. You know, if you have fans, if you have media, if you have sponsors that are actually value you enough to get behind you and think that, you know, you're worth, you know, really getting behind and supporting and cheering on, that's something that you should embrace as an amazing thing. I mean, here you are doing what you love and working really, really hard for it, and you have this community of people who believe in you enough to get behind you and be a part of that with you. I mean, that is something that you should embrace and really cherish and treat them extremely well, you know, extremely well. So that's my personal opinion on it. You wanted to know a little bit about the difference between being a professional cyclist and being a professional triathlete. They're extremely different. That could be a whole nother topic and a whole nother time, but I'll just touch on it briefly. When you're a professional cyclist, you are now a part of a team. You travel as a team. The biggest difference is that triathlon, you pick one race as an individual, have a preparation, and then go to it, and then repeat that pattern. As a professional bike racer, you are hired onto a team, and you have a role, and then you are given your race calendar based on their need for you within the team dynamic and throughout their calendar. So a pro team on the bike has a race calendar that they want to do, and then they have their squad of cyclists that they have hired for different roles, and then you get assigned, these are the races that we're going to need you as part of our squad to go and perform at. So whether that's a European team or, you know, the National Road Series in America or something like that. And often you're gone for long periods of time. So you might be gone for 3 weeks out of a month racing with your team, and then you're home for a week, and then you're waiting for your, you know, they say to you, okay, then we need you for this race or that race. And so it's very different. As a professional triathlete, you pick your races, you pick your race calendar, and it's, you know, long preparation, and then go to your race that you've chosen to do, or maybe got contract to do, that kind of thing. So definitely, absolutely different, a whole nother topic for sure. Sorry for the pause here. For those of us who will never go pro or have the opportunity to live in a full-time training environment, what's the advice you'd give on trying to duplicate some of your experiences? I like that question, and I want to take a little second to answer that. I think, you know, the biggest thing you can do for yourself is find a camp that you love to go to. I love our Tucson camp in the spring for that, because that is as close to training like a professional that amateur athletes are going to get to experience, other than at camp, because, you know, we want to make the best experience for you. We take care of everything for you. We take care of your laundry and your on-road nutrition and support and all of that stuff. So you get that, you get all the challenges of training for a full week, full time with no, and that's your primary focus. And you get to push yourself and be in a competitive group environment and experience all of those things when you go to a camp. But the one thing that we do for you is we make your life really nice. So you don't have the struggles that I'm talking about, where professionals still have to manage their, all of their own stuff, their bikes, their nutrition, their life, all of that stuff. So I would say the best thing you can do for yourself as an amateur wanting to experience this in a small dose is go to a good challenging week-long camp somewhere. And you know, we try and provide that kind of thing at the Tucson camp in February, so people get a little taste of what that might be like, and you get to be alongside people who are professionals doing it through that week. So you get to ask a lot of questions and maybe get a little bit of a view of how they approach things and, you know, and what it's like for them. So anyways, thank you so much, Renee. Hopefully this has been fun and insightful, and we'll be, you know, as time goes, maybe doing a little bit more of this kind of thing. Cheers, guys.